Extreme Finitism presents Entanglement and Bell Test Experiments, a local hidden variable solution. Einstein believed any apparent spooky action at a distance could be explained using local hidden variables. Many people thought this was his biggest ever mistake. During the 1920s and 30s, Niels Bohr and Albert Einstein held a series of public debates about quantum mechanics. In particular, these debates questioned an element of quantum theory called non-locality. Bohr's position was that there was no way to measure the state of a quantum particle without disturbing it, and Einstein wanted to disprove this. So, in 1935, Einstein proposed a thought experiment in which two particles with corresponding properties are produced from a single quantum event. These are called entangled particles. He claimed a measurement on one particle would give us information about the other particle without disturbing it. In 1964, John Stuart Bell used a principle from set theory in an attempt to resolve the issue. He produced a mathematical expression called Bell's inequality that appeared to show that certain correlations between entangled particles cannot be reproduced if all objects have just local properties, or what Einstein called local hidden variables. A theorem was formed and named after Bell. The theorem states that local hidden variables cannot reproduce the predictions of quantum mechanics. But there's a problem with using Bell's inequality in relation to quantum mechanics. If the detection of a quantum particle itself is a quantum event, then the very nature of particle detection should be probabilistic. Bell's inequality holds if 100% of particles are detected, but if detection is probabilistic, then we could never get 100% detection rate, and so Bell's inequality simply does not apply. If we visualize photons as small coins, then it's easy to imagine how its probability of being detected could be altered. Coins that approach the detector with a full face showing are more likely to be detected than those with just a thin edge showing. Now let's cover some of the basics. One way to create entangled photons is to fire high-energy ultraviolet light into a nonlinear crystal. Most of the high-energy photons pass straight through. But occasionally, one will hit the crystal lattice and split into two photons, each with half the energy of the original. Now, let's just suppose a photon has a property that we'll refer to as a polarization angle. For example, this one is 5 degrees. Its entangled partner will have a related property. And let's say the polarization angles of entangled particles differ by 180 degrees. Even though we might assume that this property exists, we can't be sure, because we've no way to measure it. All we can do is force or resolve it into one of two states and then try to detect that state. So, assuming the polarization angle property exists, its exact value is inaccessible to us, as we've no way to measure it. Its value is entirely hidden from us. Such properties are local to photons or other entities, and their values can vary. As such, they're called local hidden variables. By way of introduction to Bell test correlations, consider some photons passing through two polarizing filters. Half the photons pass through the first filter, and when both filters are in alignment, all the photons that pass through the first filter also pass through the second. Now, if we turn the second filter, so it's at an angle of 45 degrees from vertical, we find that only half the photons that reach it get through. At 90 degrees, none of the photons get through. But things get a lot less linear when we consider an angle like 22.5 degrees. At this angle, 85% of the photons that reach the second filter pass through. It appears that the probability of a photon passing through the second filter is given by the cosine squared of the angle between the two filter alignments. Now, what if we were to separate the two filters and send one of an entangled pair of photons through each of them? What quantum mechanics says about this is that entangled photons do not have a single polarization state. They exist in all possible states at the same time. This is called superposition. The photons approach their respective filters, and one will reach its filter first. At this point, the photon either takes on the same alignment as the filter, or it takes on an alignment perpendicular to the filter alignment. Either way, the state of the superposition ends. Only the photons that assume the same alignment as the filter will pass through it. As soon as the first particle hits its filter and is forced into one of two states, then instantaneously its entangled partner will end its superposition, and it will somehow acquire equal and opposite properties. It is this mysterious communication between two different physical locations that Einstein called spooky action at a distance. The probability that B passes through its filter is therefore influenced by photon A's earlier interaction. This concept forms the basis of Bell test experiments. But in order to do the Bell test properly, we need a way of counting the photons that don't pass through the filter. Fortunately, there's a device called a polarizing beam splitter that can do the job. It's not 100% efficient, but it's just about good enough for our purposes. So, with a polarizing beam splitter, we can identify photons that pass straight through as detected at 1, and reflected photons as detected 0. Now, if we include a source of entangled particles, we now have the configuration of a Bell test experiment. Here's a table that shows a set of Bell test correlations. Note that the important thing is whether or not the detections are the same at both sides or different. This table shows what quantum mechanics predicts. You're not supposed to be able to reproduce these figures using local hidden variables. But this table of quantum mechanics predictions says nothing about how many cases of one-sided detections we should expect. And in real experiments, these counts are the biggest, most significant counts of all. Bell test experiments are prone to a lot of experimental errors, but it's only by dismissing all the one-sided detections as experimental errors that a case can be made in favour of spooky action. So how might we explain this huge number of one-sided detections? Well, if on average there was, say, a 50% chance of detection, then the expected breakdown of detected or not on either side could easily be predicted. But as there's no way to record cases of not detected at both sides, we're left with elevated perceived probabilities for the three remaining scenarios. Then given that there's bound to be some experimental errors, we end up with the prediction that only about 30% or less of the photon pairs will get detected at both sides. And this prediction matches actual experimental results. The figures used in Bell's inequality relate to the long-term expected correlations between same outcomes, where there's a 1 at both sides or a 0 at both sides, and different outcomes, where there's a 1 at one side and a 0 at the other. From the experimental results, we convert the same and different counts into probabilities, and then we subtract one from the other to get the correlation values. We find that real experiment correlations bear some rough similarity to these highlighted values that are predicted by quantum mechanics. Note that a correlation of 1 means that the outcomes are 100% correlated, i.e. they're all the same. And a correlation value of minus 1 means that the outcomes are 100% anti-correlated, meaning they're all different. When we talk about Bell's inequality, we usually mean this variation of it. The original Bell's inequality was valid for a property like polarization, but not valid for some other properties like spin. But this generalized version works for any property that we're measuring. Its proper name is the CHSH inequality, where the letters stand for the names of the people involved with its creation. So how can we do an experiment to test for this inequality? First, we need to choose two angles to use at side A and two angles to use at side B. Some choices of angles won't violate the inequality, but angles like the ones selected here should lead to the biggest violation according to quantum mechanics. Then we run the experiment for each combination of filters, and in theory, according to quantum mechanics, we should get correlation values somewhere close to these 0.7 values shown in the table. We then plug the results into the formula and see what we get. If we get a value greater than 2, then we violated Bell's inequality. It's important to note that in real experiments we don't get anywhere close to the correlations predicted by quantum mechanics. This is all put down to experimental inefficiencies. Now, I think it's important to just clarify what this video is all about. It's not in any way an attempt to say what's really happening at the quantum level. It's to put forward an argument that the results of Bell test experiments can be explained using local hidden variables. Now we can unveil our hidden variable solution. Each photon has three hidden variables: a polarization angle, a detection probability, and an entangled flag. When the photon reaches the filter, its detection probability is assigned a value. A different process is used if the photon is entangled. The logic that determines if the photon goes straight through to the 1 detector or is reflected down to the 0 detector is also different if the photon is entangled. Finally, a new value is assigned to the polarization angle and the entangled flag is reset. First, let's consider the case of normal non-entangled photons going through normal polarized filters. The detection probability will always be set to 0.77. If it's reflected or not will be determined by a pseudo-random number tested against a cosine squared operation. If it passes through, then we set the polarization angle to be equal to the filter's alignment. With no filter, the default detection probability is 0.77. So we can detect quite a lot of photons. If we introduce a polarizing filter, then we detect about half the number of photons. Each individual photon has a probability of passing through a polarized filter as cosine squared of its polarization angle. And all of the 80 photons that pass through will now have a polarization angle of 0 degrees. So if we introduce a second filter with an alignment of 22.5 degrees, we can easily calculate that on average 68 out of every 80 will get through. And if we introduce a third filter with an alignment of 90 degrees, then a local variable calculation tells us that on average 10 out of 68 will get through. And about 77 out of every 100 that reach the detector will be detected. Now consider the case of entangled photons. We'll use a different technique to determine the detection probability, and a really simple angle test to determine if it's reflected or not. Then we'll assign a new polarization angle just like we did for the non-entangled case. Let's suppose that the closer the polarization angle is to either the horizontal or the vertical axis of the filter, the higher the probability of detection. So a polarization angle on a filter axis would have a high probability of being detected, possibly certainty. And a polarization angle right in between the axes would have a low probability of being detected, possibly zero. We can get this probability distribution by using the absolute value of the cosine of 2 times the polarization angle. But this doesn't work if we want to match the quantum mechanics predictions at all the Bell test angles. To match those predictions, we can use this expression for our distribution. This means that our lowest probability of detection is now 0.37 instead of 0. Going back to the coin analogy, this makes some sense because the thin edge of a coin will still have some area that can be detected. And when we calculate the average probability of being detected, we get 0.77. Now let's see how all this can be applied to a Bell test, where the filter on side A is set to 22.5 degrees and the filter on side B is set to 0 degrees. The dotted lines mark out 22.5 degree sectors, and if the photon's angle maps onto a dark sector, then it will be reflected down to be detected as 0, as opposed to going straight through and being detected as 1. The entangled photons travel to their respective sides. In this case, side A should detect a 1, whereas side B should detect a 0, assuming both sides get detected. These highlighted sectors are the only ones that will give us different readings. All the other sectors will result in same readings. In terms of area alone, this would result in 75% same and 25% different. But if we include the probability of detection, these figures will change. We can get a result that almost exactly matches the quantum mechanics predictions. We have created the illusion of the spooky correlation by only counting the outcomes where we've got detection on both sides. If we measure a property called spin instead of polarization, then we get 2 different results. These tables show how the quantum mechanics predictions differ in the 2 cases. We can extend the hidden variable solution to cover the measurement of spin. For example, consider the case where there's 45 degrees between the filter alignments. We use a different arrangement of the light and dark areas when working with spin. We simply have light and dark semicircles. These highlighted sectors are the ones that lead to different results, and again, they form one quarter of the whole area. We will use two new hidden variables, spin angle and spin detection, and we simply use theta instead of 2 theta in the probability distribution expression. Perhaps we shouldn't abandon local reality just yet. Detection probability distribution might help explain other quantum phenomena. And spooky quantum weirdness might not really exist after all. This video was brought to you by extremefinitism.com.